The idea for Artists Against TTIP came about through a conversation between myself and my brother, John Cracknell, who's an environmental philanthropist, and we were talking about TTIP, and as soon as he started to describe it to me, the scale of this issue became apparent, and what was disturbing about it was that no one knew about it. So I would start talking to friends, to colleagues, to journalists, to, you know, senior playwrights, and people had never heard about TTIP. What's TTIP? What's this trader? What are you talking about? So the idea was really simple, to use the artistic community and the power that we have, our connections with the media, to talk about the issue, to get it out into the public sphere, and to empower then campaigners to be able to affect the kind of political change that they want to affect, because we can get it out there and we can get the issue widely understood. So the aim is to have conversations with visionary journalists who understand and want to kind of get on board with the campaign, to make artworks, whether it's short films, whether it's comedy pieces for TV, short stories, all sorts of things, in order to, in a way, create a storytelling revolution about TTIP. How do we make it clear? How do we make it understandable? How do we make it accessible?
It's basically easiest to think of it as three main pillars. The first pillar of TTIP, these big EU-US negotiations, is about deregulation. If you think about business on both sides of the Atlantic, trading, investing, operating, trying to set up new operations, the thing they hate is having to follow rules, whether that be high environmental rules, saying you can't build a factory here unless you commit to protecting the environment, or labour standards, you have to apply by proper maternity rights, by, you know, holiday pay, which they don't even have in the States as a statutory right, or indeed food safety standards, which has been one of the big things brought up under the TTIP negotiations. In the European Union, we fought really hard to block the entrance of GMOs, genetically modified food, into our food chain. In the States, they're everywhere. 70% of all processed food in the supermarkets in the States contains GM ingredients. And what they're saying on the TTIP is, you, the European people, you don't get to choose. Free trade means we, big businesses, can do what we like. So deregulation is right at the centre of TTIP, and for us perhaps the scariest bit of it. You know, what type of future do we want for next generations to come? Do we want a future which is just about maximising profit for big business? Or do we actually look to higher values like environmental safety, like labour rights, like proper gender equality? All of the things that we've built up over decades and decades and decades and decades could be wiped out. So first scary pillar, deregulation. Second one, privatisation. A lot of you would have heard mention of the NHS, if you've heard about TTIP in this country. This real fear that all the privatisations we've already seen are a prelude to an even greater handover of power to the private sector. And we've seen, for example, under the coalition government in 2012, the NHS being opened up to private sector providers. So you now have Virgin providing frontline NHS services up and down the country. Well, if that goes into a trade deal like TTIP, it becomes effectively irreversible. The idea is that you're giving a guarantee to US corporations that they will have access to that market in perpetuity. So you don't get the democratic rights of realizing you've made a mistake to an incoming government in the future which says, we want to renationalize the rail, goodness gracious, or, you know, all the other things which are privatized. They can't do that because you get so hit by the penalties of reversing any privatisation in the future. And that's obviously a big political issue here in this country. So pillar two, privatisation. Pillar three is the one which has got a lot of public outrage from people who hear about it. And that's this new special power where US corporations, for the first time, will be able to sue the UK government and all other European governments for introducing any public policies which restrict their profits. It's sort of unimaginable that this could happen, but this is the new power. It elevates those companies to the level of a nation state. It gives them their own privileged judicial system, one which we can't use, governments can't use, domestic companies can't use. It's just available for the US corporations to be able to sue us. And the UK government did an official study at the beginning of the negotiations in 2013, and they said, you know, what's that going to mean for Britain? And the LSE, London School of Economics, which did the study, came back and said, you can expect that US corporations will come in and hit the UK government time and time and time again for loss of profits. If, for example, you try and introduce plain packaging of cigarettes. This is what Australia did in 2012. Bam, they've been hit by Philip Morris for a multi-billion dollar suit. And Philip Morris has said, if we get TTIP through, we will use exactly the same powers to come after the UK government, because they have now introduced the same thing. Canada introduces a ban on fracking under the St. Lawrence River. Before you know it, they're facing $250 million suit by a US company who said, we had plans. We were going to frack under the St. Lawrence River. You can't suddenly turn around and tell us we don't get to do that. You know, a couple of days ago, Lancashire County Council said the same thing. They don't get the right to do that if TTIP comes through. So that's a particular threat to democracy. You know, we surely, as sovereign people, have the right to choose whether we want GM, whether we want fracking, whether we want better terms and conditions at work, whether we want environmental standards and food safety for our kids in the future. That's really the big debate that TTIP is throwing up. There are other real threats. Even under the official estimates, we stand to lose at least 1 million jobs between the European Union and the US combined as a result. This isn't our figure, that's the official estimate done for the European Commission. Also, in terms of environmental damage, the European Commission has said quite clearly this will lead to the loss of biodiversity, species extinction, and a massive increase in greenhouse gases at the time when I thought we were meant to be sort of cutting down. But all of these things are brought into play. You can talk for hours and hours and hours. I promised I would talk for 3 minutes only, which I think I've already exceeded. I'm really thrilled that everybody's here, and I think that the particular strength of what all of you can do is you can take this message out to a really, really broad audience through your networks, through your contacts, and also through the power of your voice. So I'm really, really thrilled to be here. Thank you so much for coming. When the LSE did the study for the UK government on this, saying what will happen if these corporate courts come into being, and the LSE said on a cost-benefit analysis, there are no benefits, quote-unquote, there are no benefits, but there will be big costs. I said, that to Vince Cable, don't you think that's a bit of a compelling argument for not having it? And he said, well, yeah, I do see your point. Literally.
You've just heard from John. You would imagine, I'm sure, that the politicians acting in your name would be up in arms. They would be fighting against this terrible threat to democracy. And I'm afraid I'm here to tell you that that isn't, by and large, the case. I mean, I think that what John has described essentially is the corporate takeover of democracy. What we're seeing is nothing less than a kind of slow-moving coup. And it is very appropriate that we are on the set of Kafka's The Trial. It is a Kafka-esque world, and you're trying to understand, you know, where does the buck stop? Where is transparency? How does this happen? Simply put, most trade policy in the EU is negotiated by people in Brussels, not by the UK government here. So we send our trade minister to talks in Brussels. He or she then meets with other trade ministers, and they essentially most of the time have most of the competence, in other words, most of the powers and the responsibility. We do have, as you know, an elected European Parliament, and I was a member of that European Parliament for 10 years. I was on the Trade Committee of the European Parliament for 10 years, and you might have thought, I might have thought, that as such I might just get to see some of these documents and, hell, who knows, even vote on them. Don't be so ridiculous, not a bit of it. Essentially, on trade policy, the EU members of the European Parliament just most of the time have simply consultation rights. They don't have so-called co-decision rights. I could see some of the documents, but I had to sign something, literally a triplicate, to say that I would not share those documents with anyone. I mean, not other members of my political group, certainly not with NGOs or the public, God forbid. So I had to sign this thing in triplicate. One of the things I had to sign was to say that I would keep the said document that had confidential written all over it in a metal tin with a key. Now, I have to confess, I never did have that metal tin with a key, and so it never was kept in that respect. But it's just ridiculous. You know, what kind of transparency is that? If one person from each political group, so that probably means six people in the whole of the European Parliament, are able to see some of the documents, and even then are not allowed to speak about what they have seen. I mean, I joke not, being on this set of Kafka is entirely appropriate.
The thing that's really surprised me is how many people have just got it, because they know we're not actually talking about a trade agreement, we're talking about a corporate power grab. We're talking about democracy and we're talking about power. And so in those 18 months, you know, we've seen awareness go from, you could go and talk to virtually any journalist and any politician and they wouldn't know what you were talking about and they think you were a crazed conspiracy theorist who'd made all of this up, to the stage where it strikes fear into the hearts of politicians in Brussels, in Westminster, in Berlin, in Washington. It's gained a level of traction that was completely unexpected. And there's an enormous buzz around it. There's an enormous amount of passion and anger, and we are just beginning to see that translated now into political action as well. On both sides of the Atlantic, you know, this isn't a Europe versus America thing. This really is a people versus elites and corporations issue. On both sides of the Atlantic, we've made so much headway in such a small amount of time. We always say when we're running campaigns, yeah, we can win this. We don't necessarily believe it. On this campaign, I really believe we can win it. It's one of the most exciting campaigns I've ever been involved in. And we have won stuff like this before. If you go back to the mid-90s, a very similar trade agreement was on the table, and we beat it within a year when people started knowing about it. It had very similar provisions to TTIP, some of the stuff John was talking about. Big business has tried to push this agenda through the World Trade Organization for years and years and years. We stopped it dead in its tracks. The World Trade Organization was unable to come to any agreement. And this is a very similar issue. And just the way that we stopped those things, in just the way that we got some relief for countries suffering from third world debt in the 1990s and 2000s, in just the way that we challenged the pharmaceutical industry to make AIDS medications more available to people who needed them across the world, I think TTIP is an issue on this scale. And by exposing TTIP, we don't just stop a trade deal we don't want, we expose some of the really deep injustices and inequalities in our society. And by defeating TTIP, we empower people in our society who often aren't apathetic, but just simply don't know what they can do and don't know how to do things. I think this would totally change the way that people thought about politics, related to their society, and engaged in democracy. And if people think they can change things, then you know, there's no end to what's possible.